Let the people listen and let them make up their minds where truth lies. So it's the time factor. So I'm asking, when was he crucified? Good Friday. Good Friday. It's a Friday. What makes Good Friday good? He said, because Christ died for our sins. When? Friday. Right? Yes, Friday. That's what makes Good Friday good. I said, when was it? In the morning or the afternoon? So the clever man tells me it was in the afternoon. It was about 3 o'clock that he was put on the cross. And no man is expected to die within 3 hours on the cross. It was supposed to be a slow, excruciating death. That was the purpose. Not for killing a man. The Phoenicians had tried, you know, spearing the man, he died too soon. Drowning the man, he died too soon. Boiling water, boiling oil, died too soon. They wanted somebody to die slowly. The guy is lingering on and on. 3 days, 4 days, 5 days. Times history records, up to 6 days the guy would be alive on the cross. It was to be a slow, lingering death. That was the purpose of crucifixion. But they say he died. Okay. So, before evening they brought it down. And the Bible tells us, the Jews gave him a Jewish burial bath. The ghusl we give to the dead. Then they put 100 pound weight of medicines around him. Like we put camphor to the deceased. 100 pounds weight to put that plastering, 100 pounds. That's what the Bible says. 100 pounds weight. That's what the Bible says. 100 pounds weight was plastered around him. And they put a shroud around him. And they put him into a sepulcher. Sepulcher is not a grave. It's not a grave. It is a big roomy chamber. According to Jim Bishop, a Christian author, in his The Day Christ Died, the name of his book, he said that this tomb was 5 foot wide by 7 foot high and by 15 feet deep. It was like a big roomy chamber with a ledge or ledges inside. So they put him into that sepulchre and they put a stone in the opening and they went away. And there was a storm, thunderstorm, lightning, earthquake. Everybody would enjoy a Roman holiday. Everybody runs away home. You don't want to get wet. An earthquake. Sure. All these things to chase people away. Giving helping hands if they were there to help him, to secure him, to save him. All right. Let's not go into details. So by the time they brought the body down, hurry. They were in a hurry to put him up. Now in the Bible, this is, and they were in a hurry to bring him down because of the Sabbath. Because on Friday at sunset, it is the Sabbath. Yom Sabbath. It's the night comes first, then the day. In Islam, night and day. Ramadan starts. See the moon? Night. Ramadan first night. You see the moon? Ramadan starts. You see the moon? Stop fasting. Same thing to the Jews. At sunset, the day changes. Not the Westerner, till midnight. Damn it, or you wait till midnight to see the day is changing. But that's your system. That's your system, till midnight. You say, now it's 1 a.m. 1 a.m. morning. So they brought the body down and they put the body into the grave, into the sepulcher, not a grave. So Friday night he's supposed to be in the grave. Saturday morning, the Bible doesn't say when he came out, Saturday morning he's still supposed to be in the grave. Watch my fingers. No tricks of the hand, the sight of the hand, the guy in the circus, you know, he's clowning and he's doing this and that and he's deceiving you with his movements of his fingers. Watch mine. Friday night, he's supposed to be in the grave. Saturday day, he's still supposed to be in the grave. Saturday night, he's still supposed to be in the grave. Sunday morning, the first day of the week, when Mary Magdalene goes to the tomb is empty. This is exactly, I'm reading your Bible word for word, verse for verse. Friday night, he's supposed to be in the grave. Saturday day, he's supposed to be in the grave. Saturday night, he's still supposed to be in the grave. Sunday morning, the first day of the week. Sunday morning, not Monday. Sunday morning, the first day of the week, when Mary Magdalene goes to the tomb is empty. So I'm asking, how many days and how many nights? Come, look. It's very simple. Well, by God, no, if your eyes are not, you're not short-sighted, you can see. How many nights and how many days? Huh? Two nights and a day. Look, Friday night, Saturday day, Saturday night, Sunday morning, he's not there. Two nights and a day. What did he say? For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the whale, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the belly of the earth. He said, three and three, three and three. What we see is two and one. I want to know from you Christians whether this two and one and three is the same.
Come on.
Do you know even an Einstein can't help you? No Einstein can help you in this. Look at this man, simple exercise. Two nights and a day. He said three and three. Three and three. He repeats it four times. And he's only giving you two and one. Again, he let you down. Look, there's something wrong. That's what the Muslims trying to tell you. There's something wrong with your reading of this. I'm not saying that your Bible is false. This is wrong. No. I didn't say that. I said, you English people, man, you English speaking people, you gave me your Bible in the King James Version, and I like that English. I liked it. I like it. And now I read that Bible you gave me, and I see that is exactly opposite of what you're telling me. Believe me, exactly opposite of what you are trying to tell me. I read it, and that's how I understand. So I'm asking you, is this like Jonah or unlike Jonah? Is this three and three? Is this the same as this? I'm asking you. Look, I'm trying to be clever, funny. No, that's what I said. Look, this is what you are telling me. I read this. This is what I find here. You explain that to me now. You explain that to me. As a Sunday morning, first day of the week, Mary Magdalene goes to the tomb. So I'm asking, why did she go there? The Bible says to anoint him. The Hebrew word anoint is masaha. We do also masah. You know, every Muslim, we make wudu, ablution. And in the ablution, what we do? We wet our hands. And what do you call that? Masah. Masah means to rub. In Hebrew, masah means to rub, to anoint. So I said, why did this woman go there? He says to anoint him, to rub him. I'm asking, do Jews massage dead bodies after 3 days? Do they? You Christians, do you massage your dead bodies after 3 days? No. We are the closest to the Jew, the Muslims, in our ceremonial law. Do we Muslims massage dead bodies after 3 days? Do we? No. Then why would a woman go along to find a dead, rotting body after 3 days? You know, within 3 hours, this rigor mortis sets in. The hardening of the cells, the decomposition starts taking place. In 3 days' time, the thing is rotting inside, fermenting inside. Such a rotting body, you go and massage it, falls to pieces. It'll fall to pieces. So what does she want to do? Unless she's looking for a live person. She must be looking for a live person, because she was about the only woman, besides Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus, who had seen the final rites given to Jesus. She was about the only woman. So she knew that she had seen signs of life. If at all, if the crucifixion took place, as they say, that she had seen signs of life. That after 3 days, she is returning to give him treatment. She's worried about the stone. That now, what am I going to do with the stone? And when she reaches the tomb, pleasantly surprised, she finds the stone was removed. It was already removed. So she looks inside the cave, in the cave, and she finds empty. So she starts to cry. It's an anti-climax to what she had expected. Jesus was watching her from wherever he was. Not from heaven, from this earth. You see, this tomb was a privately owned property belonging to Joseph of Arimathea, a very rich, influential Jewish disciple of Jesus, who could afford to carve out this big roomy chamber, a sepulchre for himself. Around this sepulchre he had his vegetable garden and his country home, where he went for his holidays, for the weekends with his family. It's not out in the bundu that he was planting wheat and corn for other people's sheep and goats to graze upon. He must have had his gardeners call those people to look after his garden. This is all the scene. And Jesus is there. He sees this woman. He knows who she is. So he comes up to her from behind. And he finds her weeping. So he said, "Woman, woman, why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou?" Doesn't he know? Doesn't he know? Of course he knows. Then why does he ask such a silly question? No, no, it's not a silly question. Actually, he's pulling her leg, metaphorically. Not physically, metaphorically. He's pulling her leg. Says, "Woman, why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou?" She, I'm reading your Bible. She, supposing him to be the gardener. I'm asking, why does she suppose he's a gardener? Do resurrected bodies look like gardeners? That we all, when we are resurrected at the end of time, everybody wakes up as a gardener. So the wife doesn't know that whether this is a husband or father or grandfather, everybody is a gardener. Her son, she doesn't know who's who. Is that how it is? No, the resurrected bodies will be yourself. Everybody will be able to recognize you. It will be the real you. So why does she suppose he's a gardener? I said, because he's disguised as a gardener. Why is he disguised as a gardener? What for? I say, because he's afraid of the Jews. Why is he afraid of the Jews? I say, because he didn't die and he didn't conquer death. Had he died, and if he had conquered death, there's no need to be afraid anymore. Because the resurrected bodies can't die twice. You ask me, who says that? I said, your Bible. Paul says, it is ordained unto all men once to die, and after that the judgment. You can't die twice. So if he had conquered death, no need to be afraid, because nobody can kill him anymore. But he had escaped death by the skin of his teeth. If he gets caught, they'll make doubly sure, the Jews make doubly sure that they kill him. So he's disguised as a gardener. She's supposing him to be the gardener. Says, "Sir, if you have taken him hence, tell me, where have you laid him to rest, to relax, to recuperate, not where have you buried him, so that I might take him away." I alone, one frail Jewess, carrying away dead rotten corpse of at least 160 pounds. Not like me, I'm 200. Not like me. Jesus, sorry, muscular young man, 160 at least, with 100 pounds weight of medical, make him 260. Can you imagine this Jewess carrying this rotting corpse like an American superwoman? You know, she could do. I said, take him and carry him and take him where? Bury him as a who dug the grave. To bury, carrying is one thing, 260 pounds. Maybe this superwoman, she can do it. But to bury him, she will have to dump him in a hole. Does it make sense? She's going to dump him in a hole. Does that make sense? No. She's talking about that I alone might take him away for treatment, to look after him. Come on. My dear brothers and sisters, look, each and everything, every verse, I'm telling you now, I give you 30 different reasons from the Bible that Jesus didn't die. He was alive. 30 different reasons from the Bible. I have written a book called Crucifixion or Crucifixion. I don't know if it's available in this country, but you write to me, you should get it. Or in my volume 2 of the choice, you should get it. I can see the enthusiasm among my Christian brethren. I would rather give them the chance to ask questions. And there are 2 mics available. There's one on this end and on this other end. I want people to queue up, and then we will ask one at a time. One to the right, one to the left. One to the right, one to the left. But give our Christian brothers a preference. That's all. You Muslims also have a right to ask questions. But give our Christian brethren a preference. To ask questions first. Mr. Chair, thank you.